you for joining us. We hope that you enjoyed today's service. God is using the ministry of Lakeside to make a difference in many people's lives, and we have heard numerous stories of life change. If God has used the ministry of Lakeside to make a difference in your life, we would love to hear your story. Please email us at amen@lakesidechurch.ca.
Little did we know what we would find when we got to that hospital.
Last October, I had a massive seizure.
Wednesday, October 26th, 2016 is a day that we will never forget. That evening, as we were eating our dinner, we got a call from one of Kristen's friends saying that she had had a seizure. They had called 911 and one of the paramedics was wanting to speak to me. While answering that paramedic's questions, Kristen started seizing again. On the way to the hospital that night, we were thinking, we've been through this before. They'd check her out, and we'd be bringing her home in a few hours with us. To recover, she'd have a bunch of follow-up visits, and then life would get back to normal. Little did we know what we would find when we got to the hospital that night.
I remember kind of through people telling me, kind of through recollection, coming home from work on the one day and feeling really off.
Kristen had had a prolonged seizure, which she wasn't coming out of. At that moment as a parent, you feel completely helpless and all you want to do is make it better, switch places with them, and from that place your heart cries out to God. Realizing the seriousness of Kristen's condition, I called our best friends to let them know what was happening and to ask them to pray. I made two or three phone calls that night to Ed and Elaine, and each time before I hung up, we prayed together that God would heal Kristen, guide the doctors, and give Jeff and I peace. Over the next couple of hours, Kristen's condition continued to deteriorate to the point where they needed to put her on life support and transfer her to a bigger hospital. Over the next couple of days, as we managed the minute-by-minute ups and downs of Kristen's condition in ICU, we began to get phone calls, text messages, and emails from people telling us that they were praying for Kristen and for us. Then Saturday came. Kristen was breathing on her own, and they decided they'd remove the life support, reduce the sedation, and try to get her to wake up. Kristen did wake up that morning, and for a few hours, things were looking up.
I remember waking up and thinking to myself that nothing else in this world matters. I didn't care about my phone, I didn't care about work, I didn't care about all of the things that I had been concerned about, I just cared about life.
Then the thing we feared most happened. She started seizing again. And when the seizing continued, they put her back on life support. Within an hour, they were loading her into an ambulance and off she went to Hamilton General Hospital, a leading hospital in neurological care, including a specialized epilepsy monitoring unit, one of only two units of Ontario. We're kind of private people and not the type to broadcast our lives over social media. But early Sunday morning, one of our friends posted a picture of Kristen with a simple caption, "Please pray for our friend Kristen." People began to share that picture or post their own picture of Kristen with that same simple caption, "Please pray for our friend Kristen." And pray they did. My work has taken me all over the world and I have connections with people in many countries. We also have friends and family living across Canada, so there were literally thousands of people praying from all over the world. England, Africa, Peru, Korea, the DR, the US, and all parts of Canada. On Tuesday, Kristen was breathing on her own and they removed the life support and she began to wake up. Her EEG was still showing abnormalities and she was still showing signs of left side weakness, immobility, and overall lack of coordination, all signs of potential brain damage. But she was awake, breathing on her own, and her sense of humor was still intact. Over the course of the next few days, Kristen had improved enough that they moved her to that special epilepsy monitoring unit. Normally takes you years to get a bed in that unit, but God made it possible for Kristen to get in a matter of days. For the next 10 days, they monitored Kristen's brain activity 24 hours a day. Each day, they decreased her seizure medication until she was no longer taking any medications to control her seizures. Each day, we saw improvements with her mobility, coordination, and also the weakness in her left side was beginning to improve.
I firmly believe that we serve a God that is all powerful And when they say that nothing is impossible, nothing is impossible.
And Kristen never ceased, not once, not even a little. On Friday, November 11th, Kristen walked out of Hamilton General Hospital, unaided, seizure-free, and with a completely normal EEG. And to this day, she has continued to be on no medication and seizure-free. We serve a God who hears and answers our prayers. We're humbled by the many, many people who are praying for Kristen, including many people we don't even know. And we know without a shadow of a doubt that it was because of their prayers and our prayers that we received our miracle.
What a great story. I mean, when you listen to Kristen's story, although it's told primarily through the eyes of her mom, when you listen to her mom talk about people praying around the world and people who were her friends and people in all sorts of settings praying for Kristen, when you listen to how bad it was and how critical she was, and yet for almost no rhyme or reason, she's healed. No more seizures, no negative brain activity. And when you hear that, it sounds so powerful and so miraculous and so amazing. And you go, that is how prayer should work. That's how we want prayer to work. I mean, it's truly amazing to see the life change and the healing that has taken place in Kristen. I mean, she is back working full-time at Hope House, doing her job, doing a great job. She is the volunteer leader for our young adult ministry, The Common. And I met with Kristen this week, and when you talk with Kristen, she's got a bit of quirkiness, but she's got passion, and she's got enthusiasm, and it was just kind of flowing from her, and you could see how God has truly deepened her faith. And Kristen's family give thanks to God, because they believe that this healing was all because of God, all because of prayer. There is no other explanation. They prayed, others prayed, she was healed, end of the story, happy ending. We love that. That's what we want prayer to be all about. But not all prayers work that way, do they? They don't. As you listen to Kristen's story this morning, there's kind of two reactions that you'll experience. The one reaction is, praise God. Thank you, God. Our God is an awesome God. And there's filled with encouragement and hope, and you have this sort of sense of strength of prayer. And that's one reaction, and you might have that one, but you also might have this one or this one, and that is that it's more of a question. And the question is, I prayed for something as important as Kristen's family were praying for in my life. I prayed hard, I prayed diligently, lots of other people were praying, but nothing has happened. God has not answered my prayer. And I'm kind of confused, and I'm kind of frustrated because I watch this kind of video, and then I realize God has not answered my prayer. In fact, some of you have been praying for months and even years about something very important, very critically important in your life, and you've prayed and you've prayed and you've pleaded to God, and yet it doesn't seem like He's answered, right? You've been praying for that daughter. And she's got this new group of friends, and she's kind of going sideways, and she's making choices that you're just afraid and probably will wreck an area of her life, and she's really getting messed up, and you pray and pray that God would kind of grab hold of her. And yet nothing seems to have happened, and you wonder, why isn't God answering my prayer? Or you've been praying for your husband who struggles with some kind of an addiction. Maybe it's to alcohol, maybe it's to pornography, maybe it's to some kind of drug. And You know that it would change his life and it would make your life better, and you want him to find that freedom, and you've been praying to God, and yet nothing seems to be changing. It's like there's no reply from God. Or you've been praying about someone you love who have faced a debilitated kind of bout of depression. And they've tried all the meds, and they've been to every counselor that you can find, every technique, every course of action, and still nothing. They're still struggling. They're still wounded. They're still broken. And you wonder, God, why not? I've prayed. Why not? Or maybe you've been praying for a parent who was diagnosed with a terminal illness, and you prayed and prayed, and others prayed, and there was even the laying on of hands and all of those kind of things, and it's just been a few months since you had the funeral. And you went, God, we prayed for this. Other people are healed. Why didn't you answer our prayer? You know, maybe you've been out of work for a while and you've sent out just hundreds of resumes and you've had a bunch of interviews, but nothing seems to be happening. And, you know, you've worked through your savings and you've cashed in all your RSPs and now you're drowning in debt and you keep praying and nothing's happening and it's getting critical. And you say, God, why aren't you answering? Or maybe you've been praying to have a child, but nothing seems to be happening, or it seemed to happen, but then it disappeared, went away. And you're heartbroken. And you pray, God, this is noble. This is honorable. Why are you not answering our prayer? Or maybe you prayed for you, your battle with anxiety. Or maybe you prayed with a struggle of not a life-ending, but a life-impacting illness. Or you want just the pain to go away, or that God would give you direction for your life because you feel a little bit lost, or whatever that is, you've been praying for something and it hasn't happened. And it's heartbreaking and it's gut-wrenching and it's fear-producing. And you feel disappointed with God and you're feeling disillusioned and discouraged and there's doubt. Your faith is hanging on by a thread and hope is pretty much evaporated. And it's got so bad that you've pretty much given up on God that he's never going to answer this prayer, but maybe it's got real bad and you've thought about giving up on God altogether. And it's not like you're praying for trivial things. You know, you hear people say, well, please pray for a new house. Please pray for what car I should buy. Please pray for this or that blessing. And they seem so trivial. That's not what you're praying about. You're praying for big stuff, critical stuff, important stuff. And it doesn't seem like God's answering. And I think that all of us in this room, there's been a season in our lives where we have prayed for God to answer and it doesn't seem like he's answering. And some of you are trying to figure out all this God stuff. You know, you're trying to figure out Jesus and you're trying to figure out Bible and you're trying to figure out what it means to have a relationship with God. You come each week and you're still trying to, you got lots of questions. But one of the things that seems to be standing in the way of you choosing to follow Jesus is that you've heard other people who prayed and nothing happened. And maybe you've tried prayer and nothing happened. And you're kind of thinking, I don't know if this God thing is real. Or maybe you had a strong faith. And unanswered prayer has weakened that faith. I mean, I've been there more times than I care to admit. There's times I've wondered, God, what are you up to? Why are you not answering my prayer? You know, I'm serving you. This is what I do for a living. This is my job. I think I'm following you as best I can. I think I'm a decent follower. I think I'm doing it all right, praying right. So how come? How come? You know, I prayed this with jobs that I took that I wished I'd never taken. And thought, God, why did I do this? And never answered. Or ministry challenges or family stuff or stuff with my kids or some kind of healing, important things, I got no answer. Because I think it's the one big question that all of us have in this journey of faith, and it's this question. Why doesn't God seem to be answering my prayers? Why not? Why is God not answering? And it leaves us questioning the wisdom of God or the power of God or the love of God or maybe all of those. And we wonder, why doesn't God seem to be answering my prayers? We watch a video like this and wonder, why not me? Well, I'm going to make a pretty bold statement that I believe is a true statement. And some of you might struggle with it and some of you might wrestle with it. But this is a truth that might make us wonder, but it's a truth that needs to be told. And here's the truth. God always, always answers your prayer. He does. God always answers prayer, always. There's no such thing as unanswered prayer. And so we need to quickly review. I've taught this before, but we're going to quickly review, how does God answer prayer? The first is sometimes God says yes. Don't you love that? Dear God, please give me, please help me, please whatever. And before you say amen, it's almost in the works, and within the end of the day, it's happening. You kind of go, that's how prayer should work. And you kind of think, what did I do that time so it can happen the next time? Because we love it. When God says yes, sometimes God says wait. God says my timing is perfect and I need to make you wait for a purpose. And I've got a reason for delaying, but there's going to be a bit of a delay and God says you got to wait. But I will answer, but you got to wait. The third is not that way. And sometimes we pray and we want God to answer our prayer one way and he answers it a different way. It's almost kind of disguised and we at first don't discover it, but then we look and say, oh, that's God answering. I prayed for this and I got that. Because God sometimes says, no, I'm not going to give you that. I got to give you something different. And then the last answer is the one none of us like, but I believe is true, is that sometimes God says no. The answer is no. It's not the answer we want, because we want it to happen our way. And so when it doesn't get answered the way we want, and when no is the answer, that's when we claim, God did not answer my prayer. And I've talked on this topic a number of times, and you know, I'm going to kind of just touch on what I've said in the past kind of at the end as we wrap this up. But I want to look at this from a different point of view, and I don't so much want to look at it from God's point of view, but I want to look at it from our point of view and focusing on this question. Are there choices that you and I might make that might, not always, but might stand in the way of God saying yes to our request? Are there some things that we could do that might stand in the way of God answering our requests? And the answer to that question is yes. There are things that we can do. We might call them prayer busters or things that hinder our prayers. And it can stand in the way, sometimes can, of God saying yes. Now, we're going to turn to a letter in the Bible. It's written by a guy by the name of James. It's a great read. If you're brand new to your faith, it's a good place to start. One of those good places to start. Easy read, very practical. It's written by the half-brother of Jesus. His name is James. Same mother, different father, who had his own doubts about Jesus. All the time that Jesus did ministry, James had doubts. And then he saw, you know, the resurrected Jesus, and it changed everything. It changed everything. I mean, wouldn't you have doubts? I know if I called my brother and said, I think I'm the Messiah, I think he would have some doubts. Most of you would too. And James had those same doubts, but he saw the resurrected Jesus and it changed everything and he became a great leader in the church. And it's gotta been tough to be the half-brother of Jesus. I mean, mom looks at you and says, why can't you be more like Jesus? That's a pretty tough one to live up to. Well, James talks about prayer. And he says this, if anyone among you in trouble, let them pray. So if you've got this can be challenges or pressures or trials, let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. So prayer and praise go together. He tells us that. If anyone among you is sick, let them call the elders, the leaders of the church, to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. I did this week. A friend of mine was having open heart surgery and him and his wife came in. I anointed him with oil and I prayed over him. And then he goes on. And the prayer offered in faith, so faith is there, makes the sick person well, and the Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. So he's saying, maybe there's something here. And therefore, he says, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. And then he says these words, the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. There it is. You want powerful prayer? You want effective prayer? He seems to allude that it's something called this idea of being righteous. And the word righteous, as it's used here, means to follow the guidelines, the principles, the directives of someone. And if Jesus is who we follow, then we are to follow his ways and follow his word and his teaching. That makes us righteous. And he says, when that happens, powerful prayer happens. Now, he gives us an example. He says this, Elijah was a human being even as we are. In other words, he's saying, nothing special about this guy. He's just like you. Had all the same challenges, all the same stuff. He's just like you. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. And again, this is an Old Testament story. And he says again, he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced crops. Imagine you could keep it from raining or not raining. I mean, you'd be called by everybody who wants a good golf tournament or a good picnic or whatever, right? Call him up. He can make it stop raining. But it says it was powerful and it was effective, and he shows an example of it. But then he kind of changes. Earlier before this, he said some other things that I believe have a lot to do with prayer in James chapter 4. And as he begins, as he jumps into the section 4 of the writing, he has just finished talking about wisdom. He says there's this cultural wisdom that is kind of unspiritual, and it creates all sorts of relational chaos and all sorts of bad stuff in your life. He says there's another set of wisdom, another kind of wisdom. It's godly wisdom, and it comes from heaven. And he says you have that. You have good relationships. You're compassionate. You're caring. You're peace-loving. And so he says where you buy your wisdom from or where you get it from determines relationships. And then he jumps in to James chapter 4. In verses 1 and 2, he says, what causes fights and quarrels among you? He says, okay, I just talked about wisdom creating disharmony. What causes these? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? And the idea of battle here is that sometimes there are desires and we know they're wrong, but we still want them. And then there's desires we're supposed to have, but we don't want those. And he says, there's this tug of war. We know it's wrong. We know this is what we should do, but we battle in us. He says, you desire, but do not have, so you kill. So he's saying, you know, it gets so bad that you could kill. Now, he's using this metaphorically. You can kind of really wound and be angry and all of that, but those are all steps. Eventually, and some people have, killed over not having their desires met. He says, you covet, but you cannot get what you want. You know, you want other people's stuff, but you can't have it. So you quarrel and fight. You quarrel and fight. And then he seems to elude or move in the direction of prayer, because he says, you do not have because you do not ask God. He's moving in the direction of prayer. I think he's sensing that these people had been praying about some of their wants and desires, and there was confusion and frustration, and it wasn't happening. And he says, okay, I'm going to tell you why. I'm going to start to unpack why sometimes your prayers are not being answered. Now, what he is not saying, and we have to be cautious, he is not saying that do one of these things, and B, your prayers won't be answered. It's not always that way. Sometimes it will happen, sometimes it won't happen, but we need to check ourselves on some of this, because it can happen. Sometimes one of these can stand in the way of God saying yes, wait, or not that way, to your prayers. And so, basically, he says, you know, there's reasons, but we need to be cautious. The second thing I want to say is, these are not because God gets angry or ticked off or unhappy with you. These all flow from the love of God. God loves us enough that God sometimes says no because of things that we do, choices that we make. So let's kind of jump right in, and there's six of them all together. So the first one really is this one. You do not have because you do not ask God. So the first thing that can stand in the way is you don't ask God. Now, there are two schools of thought of what he was saying here. One school of thought says, well, you pray for it once, or maybe you pray a second time, but that's about it. And you don't ask continually or tenaciously or diligently or purposefully. You kind of pray very little about it and you're kind of gone. That's one school of thought. And it could mean that, but there's another school of thought, and I think this is what he might be writing about, that says sometimes you don't ask God because you know the answer is going to be no, and you want it to be yes, and so you don't ask God. You don't ask God. We know it's intuitively wrong, but we want it so bad that we don't ask God. And when we don't do that in this kind of prayer, when we pray another prayer or other things where we do ask God, God's going, I may say no until you ask me about everything. In other words, there's some things you're not asking because you want it this way. I'm saying, I'm only going to answer these over here when you start asking me about everything. If we ignore praying about one thing, it can affect the prayers about other things. Now, you know, if my boyfriend and me, oh, by the way, this is just an example, not a story, not my personal story. My boyfriend and me, the girl says, we're going to move in together. We're not married, but we're going to do all the things married people do, and we justify it, and we rationalize why it's okay. Culture says it's okay. There's financial implications, and I don't want to be on my own. And we never pray about this because we know what God's going to say. No. Don't do it. But we don't pray about that because we want it our way. And God says, okay, if you're not going to pray about that, then when you pray about this, I just might say no. Because I want you to bring all prayers, even the ones you know I'm going to say no, I still want you to bring them to me. Because when we connect in a relationship with God, sometimes he changes our hearts and our desires on the side. So he says, if you don't ask me, there's other prayers I might not answer. The second one is this. The second one of this, James 4:3. When you ask, you do not receive, because you ask with the wrong motives, that you may spend on what you get on your own pleasures. Now, he uses a couple of words here. The word wrong motive, we don't have the Bible's written in Greek, and we don't have a really good English word that fits grammatically. It's a single Greek word, and wrong motives could better be interpreted, you ask badly, but that wouldn't make it easy. So they kind of translate it this way. So he says, you ask badly that you may spend it to get your pleasures, your hedonism, selfish pleasures. It's all about selfishness. It's all about pleasing you. And so sometimes God doesn't answer because you ask for the wrong things or for the wrong reasons. Wrong things or wrong reasons. Too often we ask for the wrong thing. We ask badly so that we can satisfy our own desires. And God loves us too much to answer prayers that are for the wrong things or for the wrong motives. He doesn't answer misguided requests for misguided reasons. And you know what? You think that, you know, Jesus' followers, they would have learned this being around Jesus, but they didn't. There's a bunch of stories where they asked Jesus wrong things, wrong motives. There's the one story where Jesus takes them up to this mountainside, and there's this moment, it's called the Transfiguration, and it says the glory of heaven was all on Jesus' face. It was like they were in heaven. No pain, no suffering, no trials, stress, anxiety. It was wonderful. They were kind of stepping into heaven. And Peter, James, and John are there, and they're so caught up in this. They want to be living a pain-free, stress-free, anxiety-free life. And they say, hey, Jesus. He's got a couple Old Testament characters with him and say, hey, Jesus, we want to stay here. Let's pitch some tents, make some dwellings, create some huts where we can just be here forever, or at least for a long time, because we love it here. And Jesus looks at them, and he says, no. And all of that disappears, and they're kind of back in reality. Jesus says, we got too much to do. We got to share the good news that I'm sharing. We've got to care for others. We got to be compassionate. We got to start this thing called the church. He says, no, no. And he knew that it would be suffering because he told them they would suffer. He knew it would be hard. He knew it would be challenging. He knew it would be stress-producing and it would create anxiety. And he knew that they would likely die, all of them, because they stood for Jesus. And he says no. And you see, they kind of wanted the good life, the easy life. Sometimes we want that. And Jesus said, no, that's not part of the plan. Now, you think they would have got it that time, okay? So they got it. But there's two of those brothers, James and John. They go to Jesus one day. And they're brothers. And different James, by the way. They're brothers. And James and John go and say, hey, Jesus, we know you're going to heaven soon. And when you get there, we know you get the most important seat. I mean, you're Jesus. You get the most important seat. But us, we want seat number 2 and seat number 3. We want seats of prestige and power, and we're like high on the list. We're people look at us and say, look at those two. Right? They wanted it for their own ego, for their own motives, for their, and they were wrong. And Jesus said, no, you couldn't, you know, to get those seats, you got to go through some pretty tough times, and you're not going to be willing. You see, sometimes he says no because we're asking for the wrong thing and or the wrong reasons. And it's so easy to do this. So easy to do this. Here's what I think is the most common one of all. Oh God, please change the other person. Oh God, please change my husband. Oh God, please change my wife. Oh God, please change my kids. Oh God, please change my parents, my boss. Oh God, please God, change our pastor. Right? Some of you have been praying that. We think this is a noble prayer because there's stuff in their lives that's not good. But at times, if we're really authentic and real, we realize that we're not as concerned for the other person as we're concerned for ourselves. God, if you change them, their habits, their behavior, their whatever, you change that, it's going to make life easier for who? Me. And I want life easier for me, so God, please change them. See, sometimes we say that, God, please change them. You know why? Because we don't want to look deep inside to see the things that we need to change about us to make the relationship work. We think if they get fixed and they get changed and they get all the help and it's all them, then life is going to be fine. And so we pray, God, please change them. And we can do this for other stuff like promotions at work or stuff that we think we need or make life easy because they're for selfish reasons. And here's the deal. God is more important in the why you're praying than how you pray or what you say. And this is an easy trap to fall into, friends. I fall into it all the time. Well, he goes on. And he says this, you adulterous people, unfaithful, like they're unfaithful. Don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. What I think he's saying here as it relates to prayer. He's saying this, we don't have a close relationship with God. We just don't have this close relationship. God cares more about the relationship with him than he does answering our prayer. We said that prayer primarily is for what? Building relationship with God. And when we aren't doing that, sometimes he says no. Now he uses this word friends and enemies. He's using hyperbole. He's just saying these two are distant from one another. And if you're drifting in this direction, you're not coming in this direction, growing closer to Jesus. He says you're kind of drifting in that direction. And sometimes we spend so much of our lives drifting in that direction, right? Cultural ideologies and methods for happiness and wisdom and guidance. And some over here, we're drifting. We know God doesn't want it, but we still drift and we kind of buy into this. And when we do that, it says that although God is present and everywhere, it says like we're distant, we're apart from God. And then we're kind of distant. Then all of a sudden, life turns upside down and we have this tragedy. The circumstances are terrible. We lost our job or our husband's walked out the door or our kids are, off the charts or whatever. Something really bad's happening. And we think, yeah, I haven't really been close to God, but dear God, I just need you to help me. I need you to deliver me. You need to change whatever. And God knows that if he immediately says yes, we'll go, oh, thank you. See you later. And we're going to be back over here. We won't be in his presence very long. We'll be back doing life as we've always done it. And so sometimes God says, I'm not going to answer if that's what you're going to do. Because we can treat God like a genie in the bottle or, break the glass in case of emergency. And that's all we do. God wants us to come into his presence. And sometimes he says, I'm going to say no because I know as long as I say no or as long as I say wait, you will keep coming and you will draw closer and we will spend time together. And that's what I want. That's what I desire, and that's what I want. I want you to spend more time with me, and if you continue to pray, you'll be continually in my presence, and I want to be close to you, and I want you close to me, and so I'm going to say no, or I'm going to say wait, because God wants us to depend on him and to rely on him, and he wants us to draw in a closer relationship to him. I read this parable this week. It's a Jewish parable. It says, there was a king who had two sons. Each of them comes to receive his gift from the royal table. The first son appears at the father's doorway, and as soon as he is seen, his request granted. The father holds this son in low esteem and is annoyed by his presence. The king orders that the gifts be handed to his son at the door so that he will not approach the table. The king's beloved son then appears. The father takes great pleasure in his son's arrival, and the son doesn't stand in the door, but he moves to the table. And the father doesn't want him to leave too quickly. And for this reason, the king delays granting his request, hoping that the son will draw nearer and nearer to him. The son comes closer. He feels the father's love so deeply that he does not hesitate to stretch forth his hand to the royal table, and it doesn't matter if he gets what he wants. See, I think that's the parable of God. God does not want us to come into his presence and run back out and do our own thing. He wants us to be in his presence. And so sometimes he says no. And then he goes on, he says this, but he gives us more grace. That's why the scripture says, God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Therefore, submit yourself then to God. And I think what he's talking about here is the attitude we approach God with. Do we approach God with a humble attitude? Do we? C.S. Lewis says that humility is not thinking less of yourself, it's thinking of yourself less. And if we come with a heart full of pride, and the only reason we want an answer from God is so that it feeds our ego or builds us up or makes us look good or helps deal with our insecurity so that we somehow can brag or boast, we don't come with the right heart. Oh yeah, outwardly we'll give glory to God, but inwardly we know it's for us. It's about us. It's for our glory. Hey, I've prayed these kind of prayers. I have. Shame to admit it sometimes, but I have. I prayed, God, make our church grow bigger and bigger. I want more and more people to come to know you, to find healing and restoration and hope. And that's true. But there's a piece of me, and sometimes it becomes the bigger piece, and that's, I'm ashamed to admit it at times, but there's a bigger piece. I want that so I can brag and boast to my peers. Say, look at us. Look what we're doing. Look how great this is. And I think some of our leaders at Lakeside have done this as well, and I know a bunch of us have been convicted by God. I know I have, and I've confessed it to God and to others, and I have to you, that I want to repent of this and change my way. I want to approach God with humility and genuine humility, nothing for me, but for his glory. Now, he talks about another attitude. He talks about a submissive heart, that we need to submit. And the question is, am I willing to let God say no? Am I okay with it? Am I willing to God say, just wait? Am I okay with that? Am I willing to submit my will, my wants, my desires, my timing, and let God dictate, no matter how hard it is or critical it is? Am I willing? Am I willing? Am I? Am I willing to surrender to God's ways and God's thoughts and God's love and God's wisdom? Am I? Or do I pray with a less than submissive heart and then get upset as soon as God doesn't answer even the simplest prayers? See, we can fool God. We can't fool God. He sees our heart. He knows what's going on inside us. And so you may, you know, play this game and say, oh yeah, I'm coming humbly, I'm coming submissive. He knows your heart. And so we need to ask, what's our attitude? Now, this next one, it's kind of the big one. And he says here, come near to God and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Not sound like a happy picture, does it? Here's what I think he's trying to get across to them is this. Oh yeah, he says, humble yourself before the Lord and he will lift you up. And that's what I think he's going to cry. There is undealt sin in your life. I think that's what he's talking about here. Right? James said, confess your sin to one another so that you may be healed. Right? So you have to come clean with what's going on in your life. And I believe James is saying here that if you've got this undealt sin, undealt with sin in your life, God might not answer your prayers. He wants you to deal with the sin first. I mean, look at these verses. They're crystal clear. Surely the arm of the Lord is not too short to save. In other words, God is all powerful and his ear too dull to hear. No, God can hear, but your iniquities, the choices you've made that you know God doesn't want you to make, has separated from your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. That's pretty straightforward. We got stuff, God might not hear. How about this one? I cried out to him with my mouth. His praise was on my tongue. If I had cherished sin in my heart, the Lord would not have listened, but God has surely listened and has heard my prayer. He's just saying it all again, right? If I cherish sin, he's not talking about sinful perfection. If that was the case, none of us would reach it, and we would never have prayers answered. He's talking about cherishing it. He's talking about continual sinful patterns and choices, knowing it's wrong and continuing to do it. I met a woman, Jean, in the early days of my ministry at another church, and I met with her a few times, and she told me about her struggle with mild depression. She told me about how she felt lost and directionless and didn't know where to, you know, what choices to make. She talked about health issues that had continued to reoccur, and she talked about having job challenges. And she told me that she keeps praying about these things, but God doesn't seem to be answering her prayers, and she was frustrated and she was confused. So I probed deeper, and I found out that she was living with a guy named Ted, and they were pretty sexually active in their relationship, and they weren't married. And I know some of you, and including some Christ followers, don't think this is a big deal these days. And you say, well, the culture's opinion, and no, this is the opinion today, so it's okay. It doesn't matter what culture thinks, and it doesn't matter what you think. It's what God thinks, and God's not too happy with this. He is not happy, and he doesn't want that for us, for all sorts of loving reasons. And then I said to her, you know what? I've met Ted, and I know Ted's a pretty heavy drug user, smokes a lot of weed. And I asked her, you doing the same thing? You doing some of these things with Ted? And she said, yeah, I am. And I looked her straight in the eye with all the compassion I could muster, because in those days, I was a real gentle and caring person. Not. And I said, Jean, I don't know. A doesn't always equal B. But maybe this is part of the reason. You got some stuff that you know is not right. You have been a longtime follower of Jesus. You know it's not right, right? And she said, yeah, I know. And I said, maybe it's standing in the way. And for some of us, it can be that. It can be that. Not always, but it can be. You know, maybe it's your struggle with porn on the computer or lust in your heart and you create these fantasies. Or maybe you're experiencing, you know, some unhealthy relational things, or maybe you're gossiping and you're critical and negative, or maybe it's the language you use or the jokes you tell or something in your heart, like Jean. You kind of go, I know God doesn't want this, but I want it. You keep doing it, and God says, I don't want that for you, because sin separates you from me. It just does. It always does. And sometimes it takes real courage to say, yeah, it's there, and I need to do something about it. And sometimes you need to have, you know, someone to help you walk through these changes, because they can be really hard. But pollution in our heart can prevent prayers from being answered by God. They can, because it distances us from God. He doesn't stop loving us. Doesn't mean like he shoves us away. But it just creates this barrier. I think the barrier is more with us. And he says, you know, you've got to take this seriously. You know, he says to them, come near to God. That's what he wrote. Come near to God and he'll come near to you. And the reason that he says this is because he knows they're distant and they need to come back to God, because sin distanced the relationship. He talks about washing their hands. This is the outward stuff. This is the outward stuff that's going on in their lives, the choices they're making. He says, you know, shampoo your hands, or your heart, rather. Shampoo your heart. And why does he say that? Because sometimes it's our attitudes and it's our thoughts. And then he says, you got to take this really, really seriously. He uses words like grieve and mourn and wail. We need to come to God and admit and confess and repent. These aren't oops, friends. These are things that might be causing God to not answer prayer. Now, let me add one other thing here. Sometimes it's not our sinful choices, but the sinful choices of others that stand in the way of God answering prayer. Because God gave us the gift of human choice, or we call it free will, some prayers go unanswered because God will not force a person to do something that he or she doesn't want to. God relies on human cooperation, and sometimes the people that need to be answering our prayers, and God wants that, he will not force them, and it's sometimes their sinful choices that affect us. They affect us. God wants it, they just don't cooperate. And then lastly, he says, brothers and sisters, do not slander one another. And then he talks about, you know, it's about judgment and about the law, but he's really, it's the top statement. And this is what I think he's trying to focus on here. Our attitude and actions towards others can stand in the way. The way we treat others, our attitude, our actions towards others can stand in the way. The word slander means to speak negatively, critically, to gossip, to form little teams and speak against a person. See, the way we treat others and the way we act towards others and the way we think about others can stand in the way. I mean, John wrote, not too long after this, John writes, how can you say you love God? You can't say you love God and hate his brother, your brothers and sisters. You can't do it. It's incompatible. I mean, Peter says this, husbands, in the same way, be considerate as you live with your wives and treat them with respect. He says, be considerate and treat with respect as the weaker partner. He's just talking physically. They're heirs of the gracious gift. They're heirs of eternal life. He says, make sure you're considerate and make sure you have respect so that what? Nothing will hinder your prayer. He connects that to this. It's a relational dynamic. Look what Mark says. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them, so that your Father in heaven may forgive you your sins. He's saying, you want your prayers answered? You got grudges? You got bitterness? You got resentment? You're unwilling to forgive? You need to deal with it. Deal with it. Because it can stand in the way. Remember Jesus said, if you're coming and you're bringing your gift to the altar, the idea of bringing a gift to the altar is like communion or connection with God. It's kind of like prayer. He said, if you're doing that and you got something against somebody or they got it against you, go and sort it out. And then do that. Proverbs 21:13 says, whoever shuts their ears to the cry of the poor will also cry out and not be answered. It's even the way we treat the poor and the way we think about poverty and people in poverty. can stand in the way. And you know what? If we've got this ongoing conflict that we are unwilling to sort out, if we've got this ongoing bitterness and resentment and anger and grudges, and we're not willing to forgive, it can stand in the way. Now, sometimes it's impossible to reconcile. Sometimes it's impossible to get together because you shouldn't. It's not going to be healthy. Other times the person's not available or whatever. That's okay. Or maybe they're unwilling. It's okay. As Romans 12:18 says, if it's possible, as long as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. So you do your deal. You do your deal. That's all you can do. Now, those are some of the things that can hinder our prayers. Now, I know some of you have gone through the list and go, I am really ultimately, you know, I made a little, you know, bit here and a little bit there, but not very much. Not enough for those things to be those things that hinder my prayer. And I got to tell you, you can do none of those. And God still might say no. And there will be times that God will. And it has nothing to do with you at all. Don't go through this. Don't say, oh, what have I done wrong? It must be my fault. This one. Sometimes it's not. It has nothing to do with you. For whatever reason, God simply says no. It's hard to swallow. It can stretch our faith. It can feel overwhelming. But let me say in closing, unanswered prayers happen to the very best of people who follow Jesus. Sometimes there's no explanation. Sometimes God has a higher purpose than we are aware of. Sometimes he sees a much bigger picture than we do and a clearer future. Let me assure you, if God has not answered and you're not, you think there's none of this stuff. God has not stopped loving you. He never will. God has not stopped being present with you. He is. He is not absent. Sometimes it makes no sense, but God loves us and God is not absent, and he will give us the strength to endure it. The writer Paul says, three times I pleaded with the Lord to take away from me this thorn in the flesh, this physical infirmity. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. This is Jesus speaking. My grace is sufficient. For my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness so that Christ's power may rest, what? On me. This is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weakness and insults and hardships, should be in persecution and difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. And basically saying, if God's not answering prayer, the answer might be no. Don't run from him. Draw near to him. Jump into the arms of a loving father who loves you, one who is all wise and one all powerful. And as hard as it is, he will give you the strength and endurance to get through, even when it doesn't make sense. Even when it doesn't make sense. And sometimes it doesn't. And sometimes we don't know why God says no. And it's in those times we have to rest. Rest in his love, rest in his wisdom, and rest in his power. Let's pray. And so, Father God, this morning as we pray, I just want to bring those before you who have battled through seasons of unanswered prayer. I really do. There's some here who've been praying for jobs and nothing's happened. Some who have been praying to have a child and they've done everything human possible and nothing's happening. There are some who've got kids that are off the charts. Some are living with a spouse who's struggling with maybe a mental illness or maybe an addiction. Lord, I just know in this room there's lots of people who are here today. Lots who are here today who are struggling and they've been praying and you seem to be saying no or to wait. I pray, Father God, that they would sense your presence through your Holy Spirit right now. I pray that they would feel you and know that you are there and that you love them and that you're powerful and that you're wise and you will give them the strength to hang in there. Lord, give us your power and your strength when you choose to say no. May we not drift from you, but may we draw to you. In faith, in your name we pray. Amen.
Thanks so much for listening. We hope you enjoyed this message. To hear it again or other messages, please visit us at lakesidechurch.ca.